morning.
Good morning.
I'm Pastor Megan. I am so happy to see you all today. I know I talked to a few of you and we're all kind of feeling a little bit sleepy. So let's stand up as we are comfortable. Get our limbs moving. You can do a little wiggle wiggle. Come on. Welcome to Lutheran Church of Christ the King, where we celebrate the love and forgiveness of Jesus as we welcome sinners and serve the vulnerable. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Please stay in your seating area, but let's share the peace of Christ by holding up the peace sign with our hands, waving, smiling so big under our masks that we can see those smiles with each other. And let's join together in our opening hymn, Here I Am to Worship. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us
again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen.
Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Holy God, your word feeds your people with life that is eternal. Direct our choices and preserve us in your truth, that, renouncing what is false and evil, we may live in you, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
Morning.
Morning.
Please join me in reading Psalm 34 responsively. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and God's ears are open to their cry.
The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to erase the remembrance of them from the earth.
The righteous cry, and the Lord hears them, and delivers them all their troubles.
The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves those whose spirits are crushed.
Many are the troubles of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them from everyone.
God will keep safe all their bones. Not one of them shall be broken.
Evil will bring death to the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be punished.
O Lord, you redeem the life of your servants, and those who put their trust in you will not be punished.
A reading from Ephesians, the 6th chapter. Be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand therefore, and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of truth of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always preserve the supplications of all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly as I must speak. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to stand as you are comfortable for the reading of the gospel. The gospel according to John, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died. For the one who eats this bread will live forever. He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you there are some who do not believe." For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe and who was the one that would betray him. And he said, "For this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father." Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, "Do you also wish to go away?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. When many of Jesus' disciples heard him, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" Basically, this word is hard to hear. Who can hear it? Jesus, who can accept it? Who can hear and listen that you, Jesus, are the bread from heaven? Who can accept that it's eating this bread, your body, that brings life? This Jesus might be just a little bit too much. Can't you just go back to feeding thousands of people with the bread and fish like before? Didn't you see all those followers you had? This teaching is just too difficult. This word too hard to hear. These words of spirit and life, it's too much to accept. Jesus, you are being too difficult to accept. You are being too hard to hear. But it's who Jesus is. The authentic truth of Jesus is that he is more than just teacher or miracle worker. And when Jesus shares that part of himself, this holy, divine, savior part of himself, the people around him, even his followers and disciples, are uncomfortable. They were down for feeding the hungry and following him and listening to him talk about the scriptures. They were okay with dinner parties and weddings, but to be really in relationship with Jesus meant to be disciples and followers of Jesus for all that he is, his authentic, true self. I wonder if Jesus was nervous before he gave the bread of life speech that we've been working through this last month. I wonder if he considered not rocking the boat since it seemed to be going so well. I wonder if Jesus thought about excuses and rationalizations for keeping this part of himself to himself, if maybe this part of his life could be his alone for a while longer. I mean, in the Gospel of Mark, Jesus is all about telling his disciples, followers, the people he heals, not to tell anyone about him. Isn't it just easier to let people believe what they want to about Jesus? I mean, they weren't really asking, at least not at this point, so why this whole conversation about bread and flesh and wine and blood? I wonder if Jesus was worried about being so vulnerable. Apart from when Jesus was a baby, we don't really talk about Jesus as vulnerable. Mainly, because we usually consider vulnerability to be a sign of weakness or helplessness. But an author I will always quote, one that you have heard me talk about before, Brené Brown, who researches shame and vulnerability, describes vulnerability differently. She says, "Vulnerability is uncertainty, risk, and emotional exposure." And although Jesus seems confident enough as he declares, "Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me and I in them," There's a lot of uncertainty on how the people gathered will respond. There's a lot of risk, real risk. There's a reason they crucified him, and it's because of speeches like this one. And there is also real emotional exposure here. Jesus is revealing a part of who he is that he hasn't before, saying, I'm more than just teaching and miracles. I'm more than just a prophet. I'm sent by God to save you. I am the bread of life from heaven. Jesus says, I am. This is who I am. This is a part of me. How many of us have started a sentence with a person or people that we care about, feeling maybe a little nervous, wondering how they would respond, maybe scared that it would hurt your relationship, hurt their view of you, nervous that it would change how this person or people felt about you, maybe even how sharing this part of yourself might affect your life? How many of us have felt that kind of vulnerability, uncertainty, and risk, that kind of emotional exposure? Maybe even been on the receiving end of one of those revelations. I bet most of us have at least once, if not many times. And maybe it led to an entire speech like Jesus' Bread of Life discourse, or maybe it was just one sentence. Sentences that feel like they have weight, that feel uncertain or risky, that expose part of us to someone who didn't know about the full experience of being us before. And maybe it's something simple like, well, I really like pineapple on pizza, and I know that a lot of people don't. But sometimes it's heartbreaking, like the results came back, and I'm going into treatment for cancer again. Or I'm having a really hard time getting around lately. I'd really like to be there, but I just can't. Sometimes sharing those parts of ourselves with the people we care about is the hardest part about being vulnerable. And maybe it's sharing with someone you love, I have depression or anxiety or some other mental health issue. Maybe it's in asking for help. Maybe it was explaining all the support systems you already have in place and wondering if you'll be judged for it. Sometimes sharing the truth of what we have experienced, its impact on us, and just hoping to be accepted can weigh on us. For children, for women and men who have faced abuse, harassment, and violence, those statements of, I was hurt, I've been attacked, I am being abused, are some of the scariest sentences to start. We share sentences that start with nervousness, with excitement, like announcing a pregnancy, or with sadness and disappointment, like sharing that biological children might not be a possibility. Both carry a weight with them before being revealed, and sometimes even after. That nervous, worried start to declaring who you authentically truly are can be terrifying. For people of the LGBTQ+ community, every coming out can start with this kind of fear. For those returning to a life of normalcy after incarceration, addiction, or loss, fears around interviews abruptly ending, laughter quickly stopping, or awkward moments can stop us from being honest or vulnerable with others. When I hear Jesus in our gospel today, I hear Jesus' truth and vulnerability echoed in all the moments that we have been vulnerable with one another. Even when just a sentence can feel like it has so much weight, can feel so uncertain, so risky. Maybe you hear Jesus' words today and can hear your own voice sharing your story. Maybe it led to an entire speech. Maybe a conversation that was beautiful and heartfelt and real. Maybe it didn't. Maybe it led to pity, to judgment, to broken hearts, to harassment, unemployment, to danger. Maybe it was just a dismissal. Maybe they walked away. Many of Jesus' disciples did. When many of Jesus' disciples heard him, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it? This word is hard to hear. Who can hear it? Who can hear and listen that you, Jesus, are the bread from heaven? Who can accept that it's eating this bread, your body, that brings life?" And Jesus hears those complaints. He hears their responses, and he just asks, "Does it offend you?" He wonders what they'll think later, because Jesus knows what's coming next. He's trying to explain to them, to share with them, that the words he has spoken are the words of spirit and life, that who he is the word of spirit and life, but he knows that not all these followers who he cares for can hear him or accept him. And the Gospel of John tells us because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. We don't know how many. For all the fear and reaction to diagnoses, the judgment and response to sharing oneself, the pity, the change of subjects, the end of relationships, of hopes, of conversations that we might experience, Jesus experiences it all in this moment as those people walk away from them. So Jesus asked the 12 disciples, his closest, his most dear, a question that many of those sentences, those revelations, those conversations often end with, do you also wish to go away? Do you want to stop talking now? Do you want to stop calling now? Is what I said too much? Is who I am too much? Is it too difficult? Jesus turns to his dearest and he says, do you also wish to leave? And Simon Peter answers, because of course it's Peter, with his statement of belief, his self-revelation, Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God. Peter's authentic, true-to-himself statement to Jesus, basically, I am your disciple, your follower, your friend, your family. We hear you. We accept you. We believe you. Brené Brown says of vulnerability that it is the birthplace of love, belonging, joy, courage, and creativity. It is the source of hope, empathy, accountability, and authenticity. And so, of course, our source of hope, of spirit and life, Jesus, experiences this vulnerability too. Jesus calls us to share ourselves with each other, to share ourselves with God, because God already knows our true selves, all of it. Every sentence we might start, God already knows. And God says to each and every one of us, beloved child, you are so loved. You are so loved. Here is my son, the bread of life. Jesus takes our uncertainty, our nervousness, our fear, our judgment, our broken hearts and broken relationships to the cross with him, in order to feed us with the bread of life. Jesus took the risk, the violence and abuse of this world, and faced the effects of his own authenticity in his death. Jesus rose from the dead to bring us spirit and life, to bring us the love and belonging and joy and courage and hope of his own vulnerability. Jesus opens himself up to emotional exposure. He experiences the same kinds of dismissals and rejections that we experience and far more, and Jesus still calls us into something more, into something with him. Lord, to whom can we go? So that we too can open our hearts to those around us, open our ears to the difficult words that those we love might share, and open ourselves to share who we are as children of God, as disciples of Jesus, as wholehearted people sharing that same love, belonging, joy, courage, hope, empathy, and authenticity of our Lord and Savior. Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. You, Lord Jesus, you are the word of eternal life, of love and hope, of spirit and life for us, for you and for me, for all. Above all else, before any other revelation, any other conversation, any other sentence we might start, Jesus starts that sentence for us. And Jesus says, you are loved, you are forgiven, you are a beloved child of God. Take this bread. Amen. I invite you to stand as you are comfortable for our song of the day. our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. Made children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of courage, bless all leaders of your church. Make them ready to proclaim the gospel of peace and strengthen them to preach your loving word. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of creation, bless fields and orchards, protect the land from drought, and bring life-giving rain to support growth. Instruct your people in wise treatment of the world that you have provided for all your creatures. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of community, bless all who seek justice between nations and peoples. Give guidance to bridge builders, heal divisions, and inspire cooperation in times of crisis, disaster, and war. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of compassion, bless all who are in any need. Accompany all who are lonely and feel abandoned, and remind them of your abiding presence. Accompany all who are persecuted and exploited, and open us to their cries. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of change, bless our transitions. Guide all who are embarking on new stages in life, such as a new job, new school, or new community. Sustain enduring friendships and kindle new relationships and interests. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray that a new council president will be raised up among us to lead us into the future as a congregation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. At this time, I invite the congregation to lift up their prayers as well. Margaret will begin for us with some of our prayers from our prayer chain, and then we'll open it up.
We pray this day for Carol Fries in her infirmities and for Dutch, who is caring for her. For Janice, for Earl and Roxine Grosser, as Earl takes care of Roxine. For Jim Phelps, as she takes care of Don. Judy Vig and her family. Patty Wisney. Monica McFadden and Al, as he takes care of her. Kathy McCurdy. Tom Tracewell. Christopher Helly. Dick Abidell, Norma Marshall, and the family of Jim Spurline in their grieving. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. For what do the people of God pray for today?
Even though growing my mom was already mentioned, she had an allergic reaction to the amoxicillin, so she had to stop taking that and then put on something else.
I ask for prayers for my mom tomorrow as she mourns dad's passing 3 years.
God of comfort. Bless all who mourn the deaths of their beloved ones. We give you thanks for the saints who have gone before us. Renew our confidence in your promise of resurrection and life in the world to come. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Instead of passing the offering plate, you will find one available hold at the door on your way out today. We give thanks for all the abundant gifts God gives us, and in an abundance of gratitude, we share our gifts from God with the church and with our community. I invite you to stand as you are comfortable. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Remembering his love for us on the way, at the table, and to the end, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We pray for the gift of your Spirit in our gathering, within this meal, among your people throughout the world. Blessing, praise, and thanks to you, Holy God, through Christ Jesus, by your Spirit in your church, without end.
Amen.
I invite you to pray with me the prayer our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. During this time of trying new communion things, we are continuing with communing together. So go ahead and prepare your elements. You should have received your little cup and wafer as you came in this morning, and we will commune together. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you.
We have received from your table more than we could ever ask.
As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen.
The blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us be upon you now and forever.
Amen.
I invite you to join us in singing our closing hymn, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty.
You can't break.
you are comfortable one last time this Sunday. Go in peace. You are the body of Christ.
Thanks be to God.